Good Erev Shabbos, everyone. I would like to wish a Tzeischem L'Shalom to Mark and Debbie Klinger and their beautiful family. The two of you and your wonderful children have been a tremendous asset to our Oceanside community, and you will be sorely missed. We wish you much Hatzlacha in your next stage of life. This week's learning is sponsored by the Cohen family in memory of Naomi's mother, Rhoda Neustadter, the Diskind family in memory of their son, Yossi Diskind, and Suzanne's mother, Doris Paul, and the Eichenbaum family in memory of Joe's father, Irving Eichenbaum. This coming week, we will celebrate Yom Yerushalayim. We will celebrate the 53rd anniversary of the reunification of Jerusalem. And it is truly an event to celebrate, but at the same time, this past week, we also have been reminded what the cost of this celebration has been. This past week, among all the COVID-19 talk, we may have missed the tragic news of the death of IDF soldier Sergeant First Class Amit Ben Yigal, who was killed in a pre-dawn West Bank raid. Amit was a member of the elite Golani Brigade. He was his father's only son, and he was killed a month before the end of his military service. Whenever we celebrate the accomplishments of our nation in the modern miracle state called Medina Israel, we must always remember to appreciate the sacrifices that our brothers and sisters have made in pursuit and in defense of this modern miracle. And once we remember all the sacrifices made, then we realize the added significance of the war which led to the reunification of Jerusalem. Because the Six-Day War did not only reunify Yerushalayim, but it also provided stability for the fledgling Jewish nation. In the spring of 1967, our enemies predicted that they would hurl us into the sea. And the dark joke was that after Israel would surrender to the Syrians and the Egyptians and the Jordanians, we would be thrown out, and the last Jew to leave Ben-Gurion Airport would just turn off the lights. However, following the Six-Day War, the existence of the State of Israel was no longer in doubt. We achieved a sense of stability as a nation after this war. And that is not only the realization of a secular dream, but there is also religious significance in this accomplishment as well. 100 years before the Six-Day War in 1867, Mark Twain traveled to the land of Israel and made the following observation. He wrote the following: "Of all the lands there are, for dismal scenery, I think Palestine must be the prince. The hills are barren, they are dull of color, they are unpicturesque in shape. The valleys are unsightly deserts fringed with a feeble vegetation that has an expression about it of being sorrowful and despondent. I would like much to see the fringes of the Jordan in springtime in Shechem, Esdraelon, and Ajalon and the borders of Galilee. But even then, these spots would seem mere toy gardens set at wide intervals in the waste of a limitless desolation." In 1867, Eretz Yisrael was completely desolate. The truth is that the Torah predicted this according to the Ramban. The Ramban in our Parsha, Perek Chavav, Pasuk Tes Zayin, explains that when we are exiled from our land, nobody will be able to develop the land of Israel because the land awaits for our return. And we returned. And we returned not only to develop the land, but we returned to create a stable nation both economically and militarily as well after the Six-Day War. This was the war that gave Eretz Yisrael the defensible borders that allowed it and continues to allow it to thrive. And yet, as valuable as this achievement is, that is not what we will celebrate primarily this coming week. On Hanukkah, we celebrate the holiday on a date after the war was over. On Purim, we celebrate the holiday on a date after the war was over. But on Yom Yerushalayim, we celebrate this holiday on day 3 of the Six-Day War, not on the day after the war was over. In other words, the primary celebration is not the creation of defensible borders and a stronger state of Israel, even though this result has much religious significance. Because if that were the case, we would celebrate it on a day after the Six-Day War was over. But the fact that we celebrate this war, the victory in this war on Yom Yerushalayim, means that the primary celebration is the reunification of Yerushalayim. And I think the reason is that Har HaBayit Biyadeinu, the Temple Mount, and the entire city of Jerusalem, for that matter, being in our hands, embody our most noble ideals. The Midrash in Bereishis Rabbah suggests that the origins of the name of Yerushalayim is that Avram Avinu called it Yireh. By the Akedah, by the binding of Yitzchak, he named the place Hashem Yireh. And Shem called it Shalem, as the Torah states, Malki Tzedek Melech Shalem, Malki Tzedek, the king of Shalem. And Malki Tzedek, according to Chazal, according to our sages, was none other than Shem. So Hashem combined the name of Avraham and the name of Shem, the name that Avram gave to the city and the name that Shem gave to the city, Yireh Shalem, or Yeru Shalem, or Yerushalayim. The Meshech Chachma notes that the word Shalem implies that mankind together is complete. Shekol Hamin Ha'enoshi Hu Am Echad. That all of mankind is really one person. V'chol Echad Hu Eiver Me'Eivarei Ha'adam Ha'gadol. And every person is like a limb of one big person, which is all of humanity. And he writes that Shalem is a city where we work on our midos, specifically of looking out for each other. At the same time, Avram Avinu viewed the city as a place of Hashem Yireh, where he sensed the presence of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, of God, at the Akedah, a place where Avram Avinu further developed his emunah, his faith. According to the Meshech Chachma then, Yerushalayim embodies a combination of emunah, of seeing the hand of God, and also correcting our midos, enhancing our midos to see the whole world as one and each member of humanity as part of the greater whole. And I was thinking about the promise of Yerushalayim according to the Meshech Chachma. I was thinking about the promise of emunah and a feeling of shlemus with each other member of society, and I see these two values as opposing each other potentially and simultaneously complementing each other. Because if we live a life of Hashem Yireh, we constantly sense the presence of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, of God, and we feel so connected with an ever-present sense of God consciousness, and our emunah, our faith, is soaring. That's wonderful. But how do we feel about the other guy who doesn't share our passion or our commitment? How do we relate to that person? He doesn't deserve Yerushalayim. He doesn't deserve to be part of our community because he isn't good enough. He isn't a Baal Emunah like I am. And that's why we must also live a life of Shalem, a feeling connected to everyone and anyone. Sensing the presence of God in our holy capital while demonizing those who do not share our values does not embody the values of our holy city. There is a lot of emunah going around now, Baruch Hashem. There are a lot of people professing faith in God, saying that we will remain committed to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to God, even with all the uncertainty and even with all the unknowns. We still feel that Kadosh Baruch Hu, we still feel that God is watching over us, and that's so wonderful. But we also, at the same time, need to feel like we are all one. Kol Hamin Ha'enoshi Hu Adam Echad. all of humanity like one person. Each one of us is a different limb, and we work together to end this pandemic. We may disagree strongly about when we should open, when we should restart, how do we reopen, how do we restart, gradually, not gradually, and we may have passionate differences. We may have passionate differences about how we should daven, when we should daven. But we act as one. We build bridges. We try not to tear each other down. The success of this gift called Yerushalayim depends on us. The more that we epitomize both values of Emuna and Shalem, the more that we will sense the presence of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, of God, in our holy city. And I hope and I pray that in these trying times, in these times when we feel so disconnected from everyone and everything, that we will derive strength from Yom Yerushalayim this week, from our holy city, to ask ourselves how we can improve in both of these areas, feeling that strong connection to God, while at the same time feeling that strong connection to those around us. I'd like to wish everyone a wonderful Erev Shabbos.